Well, good morning, Bethel. It is good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. We are going to jump right into worship, so if you will, stand with us as we get ready to just usher in the presence of God, in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Will you pray with me this morning? God, we are so grateful. We are so grateful for everything, Lord, that you have done. We're grateful for this beautiful day. We're grateful for the green grass and the trees that are blooming, God. All of these signs show us hope of who is to come, and that is you, Jesus. And Lord, we are just so grateful this morning. I pray that you would be in this place, Lord, that our hearts would be lifted to you and that we would leave transformed. In Christ's name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Who is this king?
Who is this king? On high, enthroned in splendor, clothed in fire, his throne upon the crystal sea, with angels singing his majesty. I cannot contain his glorious praise,
Death could not hold you. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And on this Palm Sunday, as we remember that Jesus came triumphantly into Jerusalem, so Jesus, we welcome you triumphantly into our hearts. And Lord, we cry out, Hosanna, Hosanna, the Lord saves, Hosanna. It is in your name, Yeshua, the Lord saves. We give you glory, Lord.
I see the King of glory coming on the clouds with fire.
Break my heart for one. Hosanna, Hosanna, they said as he walked in. Little to know, just less than a week later, they're crucifying our Savior on the cross. That betrayal is real. And that betrayal exists in each and every single one of us. But praise God that he did die on that cross. Because 3 days later, guess what? He wasn't dead anymore. He is a risen Savior. He is a risen King. And he is worthy of all of our hosannas. God, we thank you this morning, Lord, that we can say, Hosanna, 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 and have a heart that is fully right with you. Lord, we repent and we come to you humbly and we say we love you and we fall on our knees and we worship you, Lord. We thank you for your sacrifice. Lord, we don't take it for granted. You are worthy of all of our hosannas. In Jesus' name. And the congregation said, amen. Amen. You can be seated. My name is Christy. I am one of the youth leaders here at Bethel. And man, it is good to see so many of your faces in the sanctuary this morning. We are so grateful to be slowly and cautiously and safely opening back up little by little. And one of those things that we will be doing today is passing that offering plate here in just a few minutes. But I've got a couple announcements that I did want to tell you about. Number one, I think that the Lord is going to allow us some sunshine this afternoon so that we can have our Easter egg hunt and our story time with our kids today. I am so excited. Isabel and I were here packing up Easter eggs for the kids last night. So that we can talk about the joy of Easter and the joy of what we just talked about a few minutes ago. So we're very excited about that. That will begin at 1 p.m. If for those families that are in the church now, we do have subs that will be provided for you after service so that you don't have to run anywhere and grab lunch. So we're very, very, very excited about that happening today at 1. I also want to mention, since we are starting to do a little more things, our children's ministry is starting back up next Sunday, so we're very excited about that. And we're also having our ushers that are going to be coming forward to take the offering this morning. With that being said, that takes people, right? That takes volunteers. So if you want to serve the Lord in the way of ushering or in the way of being in the back with our little babies or our older K through 6 kids, then please let me know or let Michael know, and we would be more than happy to help you get in there and get to serving. At this time, if the ushers will, please go ahead and come forward. There's a verse in Proverbs that says, all day long he craves for more, but the righteous give without sparing. I'm going to read that one more time. All day long he craves for more. How many of you know that that's what our world looks like? Give me more, give me more. I want a raise, I want this, I want that. Oh, this new catalog came in the mail, I'm going to get something. Or Amazon's right here, I'm just going to press the buttons, right? And that's good. These are good things. But when that rules our hearts over this next part, but the righteous give without sparing, then we've missed the whole purpose of what God has given to us. So I want to challenge you this morning in your tithe. I want to challenge you this morning in your offering to give unto the Lord with a cheerful heart, knowing that what we have is just his. And we're just here to steward it as best as we can. So will you pray with me as you have your offering ready? Lord, we thank you, God, that you are good. And we thank you, Lord, that we can look to your scripture to understand what we should do with our money, what we should do in our day-to-day. And Lord, I want to be a righteous person that gives without sparing. And I think that that stands for the people in this congregation as well. So Lord, help us. Will you take this offering, Lord, and make it the most glorious work for your kingdom? In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
The soldiers tried to clear the narrow street, but the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head. And he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried out for his death. On the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. Chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. Por la Via Dolorosa, triste ya en Jerusalén. Soldados le abrazó a Jesús, mas la gente se abrazaba para ver a quien llevaba aquella cruz. Por la Via Dolorosa, y es la Via de dolor, como había vino Cristo, Rey y Señor. Y fue él quien quiso ir por su amor, por ti, por mí. Por la Via Dolorosa al Calvario y a morir. The blood that would cleanse the souls of all men made its way.
That worship this morning makes it a whole lot easier to come up here and share God's word. It sets the atmosphere. As Sister Christie said, we're slowly opening in our church, but God's been very good to us through this pandemic. Church, we've been open from the moment that, you know, the judge ruled. We felt like it was important that God's people assemble together because God's word tells us that. But we did it safely, and we've tried to take care of each other, and God's blessed that. And so we're glad to be able to slowly open back up, and glad that you'll be a part of that. And so this morning, I'm just thankful for the many talents that we have in this church and how they're used. And one of them I get to deal with a lot is doing that sound booth back there in the screen. And I want to thank Sister Christy West this morning for doing it. And because Tammy, a lot of times, she'll come out of that sound booth on a Sunday morning, and she is totally stressed out. She's like, and the musicians, see, a lot of things going behind the stage that we don't see. We get to come and enjoy the service, but we don't see all the back, behind the scenes work that goes on. And Sister Christy's running the video this morning. I want to thank her for doing that for us this morning, Sister Christy. Along with others, I want to welcome you this morning to what is known as the Palm Sunday. This kicks off the most holy week for us as followers of Christ. And as you noticed, I use that term followers of Christ. And if you had the opportunity to be a part of the virtual missions trip that we recently did with some of our missionaries that are serving over in Africa, they use that term. They don't say Christian. They say followers of Christ. Because in some of the nations, the heavily Muslim nations, just because you're an American, they see you as a Christian. And what they want to do, they want to distinguish between being a true follower of a Christ and what they may perceive as a Christian. Because unfortunately, a lot of people in our nation identify as Christian because they are American. That's not anything new. Constantine did that in the Roman Empire many years ago. He made Christianity a national religion. And so by way of that, all of a sudden, all the Romans were Christians. And it did a lot of damage to the followers of Christ. Because how many of you know there's really a difference between being an American Christian and being a true follower of Christ? And church, I think we're about to see the difference. I think we're about to see those who are really in this to follow the Lord as we see some things happening in our culture. But it is the Holy Week. So this Thursday, commonly referred to as Maundy Thursday, is when we will celebrate Jesus' last Passover with his disciples. And then there's Good Friday. You might say, well, why in the world would that be good? Jesus was crucified. Why is that good? Well, it was not good for him, but it was good for us. Because without the shedding of his blood and what he went through on the cross, there's no salvation for me and for you. But then some things happened in between the time he was crucified and the time he rose again. There's a popular sermon that says, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. And Pastor will bring us home next Sunday with the Resurrection Sunday or Easter Sunday, and we hope that you'll come and be a part of that. It's a great opportunity to witness and bring some friends. Many will come on Easter and Christmas when they won't come any other time. And so maybe reach out to a friend or a coworker, share your faith, and say, hey, we're open. Come on Easter Sunday, and let's celebrate the resurrection. And I will challenge you to get your Bible this week and read about these events, starting with the triumphal entry, which we'll spend some time on today, and read it all the way through the resurrection. All four Gospels give the account. And so I would encourage you to do that. If you have kids at home, it's a great time to get it and gather around and read the story of what happened. Because our God is alive. As the Newsboys' most recent song said, our God's not dead, he's surely alive. Amen. For the last few Wednesday nights, we have been studying prophecy out of the Bible. And we've studied everything from the office of the prophet to Israel in prophecy. And we've had some studies out of the book of Revelation. And in one of my teachings, one of the things I thought important to do was to give a simple definition of what prophecy is. And prophecy is an inspired message from God. And we've seen a lot of prophecies come forth recently. And many of them didn't come true. And I'm afraid what's happened in our culture is, we're so comfortable with the Bible. I mean, we have a Bible on every bookshelf in every home, many homes in America. And if we're not careful, this is the most inspired message that God has ever given to mankind. And when we get too comfortable with it, then what we do, we start looking for other things in other places. But to me today, if you still want to get an inspired word of God, the written word of God is known as the Logos. That's where you just sit down and read it. But what I want to experience out of God's Word, what I have experienced out of God's Word, and I know what some of you have experienced out of God's Word, is called a rhema. Is when I sit down and I'm studying, and maybe there's something going on in my life, maybe I need to hear from the Lord, and I read something, and it jumps off the pages, and it hits me right in the heart, and God himself speaks to me through his Word. And he still does that today. As a matter of fact, Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews tells us this, that at various times and various ways, God spoke in times past to the Father by the prophets. But he's spoken to us in these last days by his Son. As a matter of fact, I got this from Got Questions. It says the story of Jesus saturates the meta-narrative of the Bible. And prophecies of his first advent are found throughout the Old Testament. Allusions to him also come up in micro ways, as many people and events hint at the work he would accomplish. One scholar, J. Barton Payne, has found as many as 574 verses in the Old Testament that somehow point to or describe or reference the coming of the Messiah. Albert Ettershein found 456 Old Testament verses referring to the Messiah or his times. Conservatively, Jesus fulfilled at least 300 prophecies in his earthly ministry. And I've heard some statistics about the chances that he might would fulfill just a handful of those, and it's astronomical. And I didn't take the time to research that. But what we do see is that the prophecies of the prophets of old are true. And we can trust God's word. There was a recent finding. You know, in the Old Testament, if you've been reading the Bible plan, God's people were referred to as stiff-necked. How many of you know we're still stiff-necked? We are. We're still hard-headed people sometimes. And I think sometimes he gives us some clues and some nuggets, just natural nuggets, just to say, look, you can trust my word. And one of those most recent was the Dead Sea Scrolls. How many of you have heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls? The Dead Sea Scrolls. The Dead Sea Scrolls are some of the oldest manuscripts of God's word that's ever been found. I think it's important to understand that the absolute original writings of the prophets, of the disciples and all the things, the very original writings were called autographs. We don't have those anymore. There's no existing copies of those. What we have is manuscripts. Back then, they would take the word of God and they would copy it on paper and they would hand it down and they would hand it down. They didn't have inkjet printers and laser jet printers and things like we have. It had to be written and handed down. And it's amazing within itself that you think about the scriptures being handed down like that now for thousands of years, and we still have them. But in the Dead Sea Scrolls, a little boy was, quite frankly, he was chasing his goat, and he ran into a cave, and he found some pots. And in that pot, he found these manuscripts, some of the oldest ever found. And they contained some portion of every book of the Old Testament, with exception of Esther. The most complete book was the book of Isaiah. And they're housed now over in the Museum of Israel, over in Israel. And we were there, and our guide was outside, and we were about to go into the museum, and she was telling us a little bit about these Dead Sea Scrolls. And this is what she told us. She said, you know, when they first found them scrolls, and they began to piece them together, particularly the book of Isaiah, because it was a complete book, there was some concern. Because they said, what if that book that they found says something different than what's in our Bible today? We're sunk. You know, every skeptic, every critic, every atheist is going to come out and say, see, I told you, this is all made up, this is all a fairy tale, because what you've got in your Bible, you've been teaching and preaching for all these years, is not true, because you see, here's one of the oldest manuscripts, and it's something different. Do you think that happened? Absolutely, it did not happen. As they pieced them things together, they found that the prophecies and the teachings and the words certainly was there grammar differences, punctuation? Absolutely. But the prophecies and the teachings that we read in our book of Isaiah today were in those Dead Sea Scrolls. We can trust God's word. It's been supernaturally preserved. The prophecies are true. And that brings me to the triumphal entry today, as we'll see a few prophecies of this Messiah and how they came true. So if you have your Bibles or your phones or whatever you read from, if you'll turn to Matthew 21, and I'll read from 1 through 11. It says this. Now when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethpage and at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord has need of them, and immediately he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt and laid their clothes on them and sat him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, Who is this? So the multitude said, This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. God, I thank you for your word. I think it's true. I thank you that it's true. I thank you that I can trust it. And I ask, God, that you would, my words here won't be my words, but they'll be your words. God, and you'll prepare the hearers here to hear your word. And God, and through it, we can know you, we can come to know you, we can have a closer relationship with you as you have revealed yourself to us through your holy word. In Jesus' name, amen. So, I've got a short video here I want you to take a look at. I want to give you an idea of what it might have looked like when Jesus come into Jerusalem on that triumphal entry. So if you'll just watch this short video, give you an idea of what it may have been like when he came in.
Should we use another gate?
No. The gate's important. My father will never abandon me.
So that's a video depiction, but you can bet it would have been crowds and throngs of people as he tried to come through that gate. Why? Number one, it's Passover. Passover just started yesterday in the Jewish community and it'll run all week. It's part of the Unleavened Bread Feast. It is still one of the most important feasts and celebrations of the Jewish people today. And what they had to do during Passover was get a lamb, have the lamb slaughtered, for covering for their sin, and they would eat that lamb, and they would remember that God had delivered them from bondage in Egypt. And every male would try to make his way to Jerusalem. Not everyone could, but they would try to make their way to Jerusalem to celebrate this Passover. And so they would have been crowded in there, and then no doubt they would have heard about this Jesus of Nazareth. He'd been doing miracles. He had said he was the Son of God. They were looking for a Messiah. They were looking for a deliverer. And the miracle that he would have most recently performed would have been raising Lazarus from the dead. So you can imagine how people wanted to see this Jesus of Nazareth. And so you have the Passover. You have him coming in. You have a whole nationality of people that are looking for someone to free them. And they've thronged in to this gate. And that would have been the situation. Now, there would have been another entry into that city from somewhere, some other gate. It likely would have been Pilate and his soldiers. It would have looked very different than that. Make no doubt about it that the Roman government would have known about the Passover and that celebration, and they did not care much for it. Matter of fact, if they could have stopped it, they would have. But they realized this is so important that if we try to stop this, we'll have a mutiny on our hands. So they let it happen. But what would not have been lost on them Roman soldiers was this, that a group of people who were under government oppression were celebrating the fact that their God had delivered them from oppression. And they were hoping for it to happen again. And you can believe that the Romans had enough soldiers there to make sure that the Jews knew it won't happen again. And so that's what's happening in this city of Jerusalem. And so let's take a look, if your introduction, and we'll get right into the lamb, the colt, and the gate. The lamb, the colt, and the gate. Today is commonly referred to as Palm Sunday and is the beginning of Passion Week, or the final week of Jesus' work on this earth to complete God's plan of salvation for mankind. Palm Sunday is a commemoration of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. This event, as with many of the events of Jesus' life, are a fulfillment of Old Testament prophecies that point to the coming Messiah that would take away the sins of the world. Today, we'll take a closer look at what would appear to be insignificant pieces of this story, but have tremendous prophetic significance. And the first one I want to look at is the lamb. The lamb. In the story of the Passover, the lamb would have been the central part of that. That's the animal that had to die. That's the animal that God said would be slaughtered, and its blood would be put over the doorpost. So it's the central part of the Passover feast. And I think what we do as Christians, we say, well, God, Jesus is our Passover lamb. And that just rolls off of our tongues. It just rolls off my tongue. And it's true. But the question is this: do we really realize how much he fulfilled every single requirement that God had set in place for him to be our Passover lamb? I didn't. Not until I really studied this did I see how Jesus met every single requirement that God had set in place in that original Passover for that Passover lamb. We know that John the Baptist, when he first saw Jesus for the first time, he looked and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world." But I want to look now just for a few minutes about the lamb and the comparisons between that lamb of the Old Testament and the lamb that takes away the sins of the world. Exodus 12:1-3. Exodus 12:1-3. And Sister Christy will be able to put the scriptures up for you. It says, "Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, 'This month shall be your beginning of months.'" In the Jewish calendar, that's known as Nisan. Not like the car Nissan. Nisan, N-I-S-A-N. It is the beginning of months. In the Jewish calendar, that would be January, February, and March. Okay? "It shall be the first of months of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, 'On the 10th of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb, according to the house of his father, a lamb for a household.'" So God says to Moses, on the 10th of Nisan, you're to take a lamb into your home to prepare for this Passover. Jesus, most Jewish scholars believe Jesus rode into that gate on the 10th of Nisan. As the Jewish head of each Jewish male household would have been coming through that gate likely with a lamb under their arm, Jesus himself, the Lamb of God, is riding through that gate on the 10th of Nisan. And then he says, and then Passover lambs were likely born and reared in Bethlehem. That's where the Passover lambs, most Passover lambs were born and reared, was in Bethlehem. Where was Jesus born? He's born in Bethlehem. He comes in on the 10th of Nisan. He's born in Bethlehem. And you know what wasn't lost on me is when Jesus was born, and the Bible says that the angels appeared to the shepherds keeping watch over their flocks by night. The angels appeared to shepherds watching over what is likely Passover lambs while the Lamb of God is laying in a manger. God's word's fulfilled, and it's true. It was to be a lamb without blemish. Look at Exodus 12:5-6. Exodus 12:5-6. God says to Moses, "Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. Now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight." It's to come in to the household on the 10th of Nisan. They're to keep it till the 14th of Nisan. 4 days. And for 4 days, they're to examine that lamb. They're to make sure it doesn't have a spot. They'll make sure it doesn't have a blemish. Jesus rides into Jerusalem on the 10th of Nisan. He's examined for 4 days. You say, well, how's he examined for 4 days? He goes to Annas, the priest. He goes to Caiaphas, the high priest. They send him to Pontius Pilate. Pilate sends him to Herod. Herod, like a lot of Americans today, just wants to see a miracle. He doesn't really know, put his trust in Jesus. He sends him back to Pilate, forcing Pilate himself to say this in Luke 23:4. So Pilate said to the chiefs and of the crowd, "I find no fault in this man." Examined for 4 days. "I find no fault in this man." He even prompted Pilate's wife to have a dream, and she comes to Pilate and she says, "Have nothing to do with this just man. I've had a terrible dream." the Lamb of God comes in on the 10th of Nisan. It's reared in Bethlehem. It's examined for 4 days. The lamb was not to be killed inside of the gate. Deuteronomy 16 and 5, God says to Moses, "You may not sacrifice the Passover within any of your gates, which the Lord your God gives you." Jesus was crucified outside the walls of Jerusalem. John 19 and 20 says, "Then many of the Jews read this title that was written." Then many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. Most believe he was not crucified inside the city. And at the very same time that Jesus would have been hanging on that cross being crucified, the Passover lambs would have been being slaughtered. This is what one Jewish scholar said about that. He said, "Friday, the day of preparation, Jesus is tried and executed, although never convicted. The Jews continue their Passover celebrations with the Shagah, offerings made during the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. Therefore, Passover lambs were still being slain while Jesus was being crucified." He comes in on the 10th of Nisan. He's examined for 4 days. He was born in Bethlehem. He was crucified outside the city gate. While he's being crucified, the Passover lambs are in the temple being slain. Everything that's needed is being done. Every single requirement that God said for that Passover lamb, Jesus Christ, Jesus of Nazareth, is fulfilling. We can trust his word. What's the chances of that? In the old Passover, they were to take that lamb's blood, Moses said, and put it over the doorpost because the angel of death was coming. Moses had been to Pharaoh several times saying, "Let my people go, let my people go." You know, Pharaoh was a hard-headed guy because he had had all these plagues of lice, water turning to blood, their cattle had died, all these things, and Pharaoh would say, "Okay, I'll let them go now." And then he wouldn't. But this time, God said to Moses, "Take this lamb, take it into your house, examine it 4 days, slaughter it, put the blood over the doorpost. The angel of death is coming. And if it sees that blood on the doorpost, it will pass over." And sure enough, the angel of death came, and it passed over the homes of God's people. And Pharaoh's firstborn was slaughtered, and it caused him to turn God's people loose. Lamb's blood over the doorpost in Egypt resulted in freedom from bondage. Christ's blood on our heart results in freedom from the bondage of sin. There's a story told of a dream that Martin Luther had. And he said he had this dream, and Satan came to him with a scroll. And on that scroll was written every sin he had ever committed. Could you imagine that? I don't know about your scroll, but my scroll would be pretty thick. He come in here with this scroll, and he began to unroll it. Every sin of thought, word, deed, your past, 10 years ago, 10 minutes ago, whatever it was. And he begins to unroll this scroll to Martin Luther and show him his sin. And in this dream, Martin Luther, the devil continues to roll that scroll. And that's what he does today. He comes to us and he's an accuser of the brethren. He constantly reminds you that you're not good enough, of your past, of your struggles. And he unrolls that scroll. But in this dream, he rolls the scroll all the way out, and Luther's head is hung. But he notices that the scroll is not rolled all the way out. Until finally he looks at Satan, he says, "Unroll it all the way." And when it comes all the way in, written in red at the bottom of it is, "Forgiven by the blood of Jesus." That is for us today. That's what happened with that lamb. God allowed that the blood of the Passover lambs to be a covering for the sin. Sin is only forgiven through the blood of Christ. Once and done. It had to be done year after year after year in the old covenant. Hebrews tells us that what the blood of the lamb and the bulls and the rams could not do, his blood did. But it demands that we respond. It's a good story. It's a motivating story, but it demands that we come and respond to it and put our trust in it and repent of our sin and turn to him and apply that blood to our lives. The lamb. And then there's the colt. The colt. In 21:5, it says, "Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly, and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foil of a donkey. Jesus had told his disciples, he said, go into Bethany. You'll find a colt there, a foal. Bring it to me. One of the things that we determined as we studied in our prophecy study is the key determination of a true prophet is the things that they say are going to happen, happens. Well, Jesus was a perfect prophet. And when he told his disciples to go into this city, they found exactly what he said they would find, a colt. But Mark's gospel and many of the other gospels in Mark 11 and 2 say this about that colt. And he said to them, go into the village opposite you, and as soon as you've entered, you will find a colt on which no one has sat. Loose it and bring it to me. And I read that and I thought, wonder why that's in there. What was significant about the fact that this colt, this donkey that Jesus would ride on, nobody had ever sat on it. And then we go to look back into the prophecies, into the Old Testament, and about see maybe a foreshadowing of why that might be the case. Jesus had perfectly fulfilled Zechariah 9:9 when he came riding into that city through that gate. But then that colt had never been ridden. But we have to just simply look back to the red heifer. For you city slickers like me, a heifer is a cow. I wasn't 100% sure. I was like, what is a heifer? I need to get this right if I'm going to come up and tell people what it is. It's a cow. And it was used for the purification ceremony, to purify for sin, to purify the temple. And what they would do, they would take it, they would sacrifice it. Well, let me read it. Look at Numbers 19:1 through 3. Tell a little bit about it. It says, now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, saying, this is the ordinance of the law which the Lord has commanded, saying, speak to the children of Israel that they may bring you a red heifer without blemish, in which there is no defect, on which a yoke has never come. You shall give it Eleazar the priest. He may take it outside the camp, and it shall be slaughtered. So they would take this cow, and it had to be perfect, and it was a red heifer, and they would slaughter it. But it had to be one that had never had a yoke on it. It could have never had a burden on it. And so we see a foreshadowing of this donkey, that the Son of God, the only lamb that could give complete forgiveness and purification of sin, would ride on a donkey that had never been ridden. Something interesting about the red heifer, I don't spend a lot of time on it, but they say there's been only nine of those born from the time of Moses to now. Many believe the 10th one will usher in the Messiah. In 2018, one was born in Israel, and they're still examining it to see if it meets the requirement. Now, what does that mean? I don't know. There's a temple institute. There are those who are getting all the artifacts to rebuild another temple. Many believe in the end times when Jesus, there will be another temple. It will there? I don't know. But I think the time is getting close, and I think we see many fulfillments. And then there's the cart for the ark. I had to say that several times so I didn't stumble over that. The cart for the ark, and that's found in 2 Samuel 6 and 3. Now, the ark here is the Ark of the Covenant. That's what God's presence rested in. It was a wooden box that God gave specific instructions on how to build out of a certain wood. It was covered in gold, and within it were the Ten Commandments. And that's what the children of Israel carried with them to signify the presence of God. And when they would set up a tabernacle, they would set this ark in the Holy of Holies, and God's presence would rest there. But it had been captured by the enemies, and David was bringing it back to Jerusalem, and it was going to be an exciting time. And this is what it happens in 2 Samuel 6 and 3. It says, so they set the ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Adinabab, which was on a hill, and Uzzah and Ahio and the sons of Adinabab drove the new cart. So here you have David with a brand new cart. This is the presence of God. The ark signifies and is the presence of God. It is to set on a brand new cart. Nothing is worthy to set on this cart before or after that. Jesus says, bring me a donkey. Nothing is worthy to set on that donkey because the very presence of God is going to set on that donkey. The lamb, the colt, and finally, the gate. When I was looking for a video to kind of show you a little bit about the triumphal entry, I already had this outline in place before I saw this video. And I don't know if you could hear it or not, but as they were approaching, the lady said, "Should we pick another gate?" And the man who was playing Jesus said, "No, the gate is important." Because the gate is important. That gate was known as the Eastern Gate. The city of Jerusalem was surrounded by walls. It had 8 gates. The Eastern Gate, also known as the gate called Beautiful. If you remember in the book of Acts where Peter and John was going up to pray and they saw a man begging, they said he was laying at the gate called Beautiful. That would have been the Eastern Gate. And the reason it would have been used then is because it was the most direct access to the Temple Mount. And when you read in the Bible, you know, everything in the Bible is significant, and it's true. When you read in the Bible and it says they went up to Jerusalem to pray, that's because that Temple Mount is up, isn't it, Pastor and Carol? It is a straight-up walk, so much to the point they have a golf cart down there for people who are physically challenged, because it's a straight-up walk. But that gate is important, because we have to simply look back at Ezekiel's prophecy of that gate some 600 years before Jesus would come through it, and what he had to say about the gate. Let's look at Ezekiel 43, 1 through 4. Ezekiel had a vision from the Lord, and this is what it said. It says, "Afterward he brought me to the gate that faces towards the east. And behold, the glory of the God of Israel came from the way of the east. His voice was like the sound of many waters, and the earth shone his glory. It was like the appearance of the vision which I saw, like the vision which I saw when I came to destroy the city. The visions were like the vision which I saw by the river Shebar, and I fell on my face. And the glory of the Lord came into the temple by way of the gate which faces to the east." Now, in full disclosure here, this gate, I'm going to ask Sister Christy, will you put that gate up, that picture I have up for me? Okay, it's up. It's not up there. Okay. I took this picture, so I wanted you to be able to see it as I speak. I took this picture from the Mount of Olives, and so I just wanted to leave that up there for a minute as I speak. Do you see? You see the double arches? That's the Eastern Gate. That is the Eastern Gate, and it faces toward the east. And the vision that Ezekiel saw said he saw the glory of Israel come from the east, which would have been towards the Mount of Olives. It said his voice was like the sound of many waters. Read Revelation and see how John described the vision of Jesus. The glory of Jesus said his voice was like the river of many waters. You know, scriptures can have multiple fulfillings. And I believe this scripture has a multiple fulfillment. I believe when Jesus got on the donkey and rode through that gate, that was a fulfillment of Ezekiel's vision. Now, that is not the gate that Jesus drove through. I want you to know that. That gate, that wall has been destroyed. It's under that. And that gate has been rebuilt, and we'll look at that in just a moment. But that is the gate. The Eastern Gate is the gate that Jesus entered on that triumphal entry. And then let's take a look at Ezekiel's prophecy now about that gate. Look at Ezekiel 44, 1 through 3. It says, "Then he brought me back to the outer gate of the sanctuary, which faces towards the east, but it was shut. And the Lord said to me, 'The gate shall be shut, it shall not be opened, and no man shall enter it, because the Lord, the God of Israel, has entered by it. And therefore it shall be shut. As for the prince, because he is the prince, he may sit in it to eat bread before the Lord. And he shall enter by the way of the vestibule of the gateway and go out the same way." As you can see, that gate now is shut. It's sealed up. And I want to tell you how that happened. The Eastern Gate was sealed shut in AD 1540-41 by order of Suleiman the Magnificent, a sultan of the Ottoman Empire. The area of which Jerusalem is under Muslim control of the Ottoman Empire. And the leader is the Suleiman the Magnificent, and he seals this gate. Why? It's believed that the reason for closing the Eastern Gate was to prevent the Jewish Messiah from gaining entrance to Jerusalem. Jewish tradition states that the Messiah will pass through the eastern gate when he comes to rule. The Muslim Suleiman was attempting to thwart the Messiah's plans with 16 feet of cement. So that's why it's sealed up like that. It's got 16 feet of cement in front of it. But not only that, if you go up there near it, you can't see it here, but, and it's not that big, but right in front of the gate is a wrought iron fence, and in front of that is tombs. Because they said, okay, surely the Jewish Messiah won't walk over these tombs. If you've been reading in the Old Testament, that was a no-no. And I've got these 16 feet of concrete there to make sure that this Jewish Messiah never comes through this gate again. The eastern gate has remained sealed for nearly the past 500 years. We have Jesus fulfilling every requirement of the Old Testament for to be the Lamb of the God. We see that he was a foreshadowing in that riding that colt by that red heifer and that cart. We see the gate that he come through to ride in lowly on a donkey to come into Jerusalem to be unlawfully tried, to be crucified and buried and to rise again. We see all that, and we see how many years ago those things were prophesied and they happened just as he said. Many of them in Zechariah 9:9, just as it said. So what that says to me is that the prophecies of what's going to happen in the future, I can trust them. I can know they're going to happen, and I can look into God's word and see how they're going to happen. Zechariah is probably the most messianic prophetic book of the Old Testament. And this is what Zechariah says about the coming of the king. It says, then the Lord will go forth and fight against those nations as he fights in the day of battle. And in that day, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives, which faces Jerusalem on the east. And I'm going to stop there. I believe that the Messiah is coming back. Our Lord is indeed coming back. And I believe when Zechariah said he's going to set his foot in the Mount of Olives, I believe that. When I stood there and took that picture standing there in the Mount of Olives, I'm up high, I'm looking over at that eastern gate, I'm thinking about these prophecies, because what you have to do is come down from those Mount of Olives, as he did when he rode into Jerusalem during the triumphant entry. You go across what's called the Kidron Valley, and you walk into the eastern gate. Well, I believe he's coming back to the Mount of Olives, just like Zechariah said, but he's coming back differently this time. And I believe John's vision is how he will return this time. When John said, now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. It wasn't a donkey. He didn't come in lowly. He came in on a white horse. And he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself... He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God, and he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. They can put 1,000 things of concrete over there. They can put all the cemeteries they want in there. In God's appointed time, Jesus, his son, is coming back to this earth. I believe he will sit in the Mount of Olives. I believe he will come down, and I believe he will walk right back through that gate. Will there be a temple then? I don't know. But I know he will sit in Jerusalem, and he will rule the nations. And I plan on being with him. I have my trust in him. And today I can rejoice that that's going to happen, but we have to put our faith in him. We have to be overcomers, and we have to be willing to stay true to his word. I'm going to ask Matt and the team if they will to come forward. All those prophecies were fulfilled, church, in Jesus when he made that triumphal entry. And that prophecy of Zechariah and that vision of John the Revelator is coming true. I don't know when. I don't know how. But I know it's going to come true. But really, what's more important for us today than that? And that's exciting, because I get so tired of the foolishness that I see going on in our country today. If you know anything about what's happening around the world, our brothers and sisters, the martyrdom of Christianity is worse than it's ever been. We hear of Christians being beheaded, of all their belongings being taken from them. We see the early stages of social persecution here. But probably the most important part of that passage of Scripture in Matthew 21, 1 through 11, was this. It says in verse 10, it says, "And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, 'Who is this? Who is this?'" So the question for me today and for you today is, who is this to you? Who is it to you? There were crowds of people out there. Be careful of following the crowd. You can bet that a lot of the people who were standing out there saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David," were some of the same people who were later standing in the crowd saying, "Crucify him." Because they weren't really followers of the Lord. They were looking for somebody to do something for them immediately. Who is this? To the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they hated him. He was threatening their rule. And they were bound and determined to kill him, and they did, but they didn't stop him. And Pastor will talk about the resurrection next week. To the Jews out there, he was the Son of David. To them, that's a messianic term, but to them, he was the one maybe that was going to free them from Roman rule. And I'm afraid we have too many American Christians today. They think Jesus is going to deliver us from these crazy liberals or these crazy Republicans. That's never been Christ's mission. I heard someone say recently, and it bothered me, that America has an end date. And I'm very concerned about what's happening in our nation. But the kingdom of God does not. There's no end date. And so as much as I'm concerned, as much as I'm going to do my part for my nation, Jesus came to build his kingdom. And how do we do that today? Put our trust in him. We put our trust in the finished work. We repent of our sin. And then we make him the Lord of our life. That's the hard part. That's what's gotten lost in the culture. No more lordship. What do you mean? I got to follow him? I got to try to live like he lived? Give like he gave? Love people? Forgive people? Live according to his word? Count me out. I can go find some church to let me live any way I want to live. Well, they're doing you a huge disservice. Because I'm going to stand before him one day. And the only thing that's going to matter is when he looks at me, does he see the blood over the doorpost of my heart? It's not going to matter what I've done bad. It's not going to matter what I've done good. And the reason I try to live godly before him now is because I recognize what has been done for me. And I thank God for it. And so I'm going to ask all of you will to stand. This morning, if you never put your trust in the Lord, you've never applied that blood to your life, they're going to sing a song. I'm going to ask you to come down, and we'll pray with you. Times are changing, folks. The times are changing. And so I know it's my desire, I know it's Pastor Don's desire, and all of our church's desire that know the Lord is that you know the Lord, and that you're prepared to stand before him. And so I'm going to ask you to say, if every head will bow and every eye will close, as they sing, this morning, if you've never put your trust in Christ for your personal salvation, this altar is open. And Pastor will come up in a moment. We believe, and I'm so glad we can start finishing with our altar again. We're doing it incrementally. And in a moment, he's going to come up, and we're going to start coming back to our altar again. If you're visiting us this morning, we just believe in coming and standing around the altar and just praying and worshiping the Lord a little bit and praying for each other's needs. We will ask that you, at this phase, if you'll come down, if you'll just put your mask on. But we just want to pray and be in God's presence. But right now, this is about salvation, and the pastor will give us an opportunity to pray for each other individually for our needs. So as they sing, if you've never put your trust in Christ, or maybe you have, and you're like, I've just let some things, I'm not where I need to be. That would be my testimony years ago. I'm not where I need to be. Come make it right. Come make it right, Brother Matt.
Crimson love.
sing it. Challenge you to come. I know you can receive where you're standing, and we all know that. God's back there just like He is here. But I like the idea, and this is our first Sunday. It's been over a year since we've been able to really gather together in the altar. And if you want to come with your mask on, please feel free. But could we come and sort of get close together? There's nothing like fellowship. I miss hugging people. Don't you miss hugging people? Shaking hands. Brother Matt, one more time, let's praise God. Would you come and gather around the altar? But if you don't feel comfortable doing that, we understand. Blood of Jesus, oh, the blood of Jesus. You love Him, sing it. So thankful this morning that we've been able in some measure to experience that great triumphant entry. Lord, we thank You for Your word. And we thank You, Lord, for men that will preach it and teach it and make it real to us. Lord, we're so thankful for Your presence in this place. May every man, every woman, every family, every home be immensely blessed by Your grace and Your mercy. In the name of Jesus, we pray. If you're here this morning, if you have a special need, we do believe that God will be able to minister. We believe in praying one for the other. The Bible says, if two of you shall agree as touching any one thing, it shall be done. If you have a special need, we want to come in agreement with you. Just lift your hand or step out. We have prayer warriors here. But if you have a special need, Maybe you're sick. Maybe you don't. Maybe you have lost loved ones. Whatever your need might be, let's believe the Lord right now. Just slip up that hand. We're going to come in agreement. Sing. Some are being prayed for. Sing it. Washes white as singing over. Are still being met. Sing it one more time. Just believe the Lord as we pray. All of us have experienced the application of the blood of Jesus Christ to our doorpost. And we know the experience of being born again. We thank you. Amen. It's been several years since my wife and I were in Jerusalem, walking down that narrow street of Via Della Rosa. But I can truly say, Ann, you took me down that street today. I've never heard that song any more beautiful than it was sung today. Would you praise God for that? Brother Larry Smith, thank you so very much for the message and challenge in our hearts today. We appreciate it so very much. Amen. Thank all of you that viewed us online. We appreciate that. Appreciate your support. Thank you during this special time and sometimes hard time with the sickness that you've been able to send your funds and bless the church. And we thank so much your support. Thank you for all of our guests. Lib Jones, you're very special. I want you to know that. You have such an influence over people. And it's because of the life that you've lived and the testimony that you have. And we appreciate that so very much. Father, we love you today. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings, the outpouring of your Spirit. Thank you again for your word. Thank you for the touch of your hand. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Have a great day.